So last night, the Joe Biden campaign put out this incredibly cringy video, and I want you to watch it, and I want you to pay attention specifically to how little policy substance there is. And then we're going to come back and talk about why it is the case that liberals keep putting out these ads that have absolutely no policy substance, and yet people keep praising them. So let's watch this video, make fun of it, and then we'll be back to have a little bit of a more serious conversation.
Keegan, do you have any threes?
No, I don't.
Do you have any nines?
Yeah. I always start with dessert.
Is the name Maurice funnier than Martin?
I like Maurice.
One R. Yeah, don't try too hard.
Working on a speech that I'm going to need you to deliver.
You should try to find a place for the word loquacious.
$41 down, comedy duo Key and Blank. How many E's in Peel?
Three E's in Peel. Three.
That's 13.
Come on, Keegan, you can do 20. Keegan, I do everything 46 these days.
That's 20.
Do 30, Keegan, 30. 10 more.
Come on, Joe.
30. Keegan, do you have any threes?
I do, Joe. Yes, I do.
So there you go, probably the cringiest video you're going to see all day, but first let's talk a little bit about the background behind this thing. Why does this video even exist in the first instance? Well, as you know, Joe Biden's campaign is really struggling to figure out how they can go viral. Obviously, in a world with this pandemic going on, you know, you can't do the typical handshake, typical large rally stuff that Joe Biden is used to. And Joe Biden, therefore, needs to figure out how he can go viral in an internet age. And lovely, particularly, this article opens up with the fact that Joe Biden admits that he needs the help of his granddaughter to figure out how he can use his iPhone. So lovely way to open an article about this, but basically Joe Biden's campaign being staffed up the way that it is really having a hard time figuring out how to navigate the social media landscape in a way which is appealing to an audience and be able to get his message across. And so in this particular article, they focus on how Joe Biden's campaign strategy is attempting to sort of remind people of kind of 2012-2013 Upworthy type content and make basically sort of feel good news that people click and people share and et cetera. And they're specifically trying to target something known as the suburban Facebook empathy mom. So, you know, the sort of white suburban upper middle class, you know, wine moms who want to just share content and, you know, that the hope is that that will be how this sort of information spreads and that that's how Joe Biden can maintain relevancy and people can see him in the public eye in the middle of this pandemic. Now, obviously, I mean, this is in many respects laughable on his face. You would think, for instance, that Joe Biden could, being that he's the presumptive Democratic nominee, could let it lay out a set of policy agendas and make the Democratic Party, make, you know, everybody in Congress bow. In many respects, he probably could make them bow to that policy agenda and then make the, you know, basically all of the news shape around a debate between Joe Biden's policy proposals and Trump's policy proposals. That would be what Joe Biden would do if he was smart. But no, Joe Biden didn't ask me. He didn't ask you what he was going to do. This is the idea that he came to. He wants to provide shareable content, which has absolutely no policy substance to it. But there's actually a deeper reason why Joe Biden and why liberals in general don't have much policy substance to go around, especially during times of crises. And that's to do with the way in which liberals and especially neoliberals, which in many respects, liberals and neoliberals are basically the same thing, at least how I map the ideologies. And the reason for that is because deep in sort of neoliberal and liberal logic is this idea of a public-private distinction, which is kind of like a deep sort of a deep-seated legal distinction where there's a private sphere and there's a public sphere. And the role of government, the role of politics, the role of a politician is merely to manage the economy and merely to sort of sit over the economy. And, you know, the role of government, the role of sort of policy debates is just to manage the negative externalities which result from the market. But I want to challenge that. Just as a leftist myself, and personally, you know, my view is that leftism is as dissimilar from liberalism as conservatism is from libertarianism. In the same way that, you know, like it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense to say that like libertarians are to the right of conservatives. Like it doesn't, like that's not really how you would map it. In the same way, I don't know that it really makes a whole lot of sense to say that leftists are to the left of liberals. I think that that's like just a sort of unfortunate effect of naming that we're called leftist. I think that just like a different set of ideologies, maybe socialist or, you know, anarchist even possibly, I don't know, would be just like a better way to present ourselves. But anyway, I want to make an argument against this distinction. And to do that, I want to go back to a 1948 Supreme Court case. Now, this is going to seem like a bit of a tangent, but I promise I'm going to bring us back. So in 1948, the Supreme Court case had a famous Supreme Court case, a landmark Supreme Court named Shelley versus Kramer. And in the Supreme Court case, which no doubt you've studied if you went to law school or you took any kind of pre-law or, you know, whatever law courses or law classes in college or whatever, you've no doubt studied this case because it's a landmark case which struck down racially restrictive housing covenants. So basically what happened was there was a sort of a neighborhood that got together like decades earlier, and they had all agreed that basically they weren't going to allow any black people to move into this neighborhood. Well, a couple decades later in sort of 1945-ish, a black family moved in. They sold, you know, they bought the home and they moved in. And basically, then, you know, a few of the neighbors remembered this contract, remembered how this was, you know, in part of the, you know, lease that they had basically all signed together, collectively signed, and it had got, you know, passed down basically through the owners. And so they sued. And the lower courts upheld the private contract. They said, well, yeah, look, it's in the contract that black people can't move in, that you can't sell the home to black people. So, of course, you can't buy this home. But then when it got to the Supreme Court case, basically the African-American family was arguing that this violates their 14th Amendment equal protection rights, that we have an equal protection right under the law. And so by saying that black people cannot, you know, live in, you know, certain that this kind of contract is allowed basically violates our equal protection. Well, you would think that if, you know, basically your basic knowledge of, you know, court cases and legal reasoning using this public-private distinction would be that, well, this is doomed to fail because, you know, for instance, like if you've ever been online or, you know, seen any kind of internet arguments, your First Amendment rights, your, you know, just general Bill of Rights only apply to the government, right? This is why you don't have free speech at work. You don't have, like, right, like if you go into Walmart and start screaming out cuss words or something like that, they can kick you out because you don't have free speech on private property. So in the same way, you would think that the Supreme Court would basically be like, nah, this doesn't really work for you. Well, that's not the reasoning that the Supreme Court came to. The Supreme Court decided to side with the African-American family. Basically, and the reasoning, the logic behind this decision is that while, yes, it is true that the state is not involved in the formation of this contract, the state is involved in the enforcement of the contract, right? Like, it's going to be the state who ends up kicking you off of your property. And so, as a result, you know, the sort of radical implications of this, by the way, are, I mean, the implications of that decision are incredibly radical, very, very radical. And if you actually go through, like, you know, when I studied this in school, most of the secondary literature on this court case concludes that actually the decision was reasoned wrongly, right? Like, it was decided incorrectly. Now, that's not to say that all those people making that argument are, like, actively racist. It just means that they think that, like, legally the Supreme Court made the wrong decision because legally that's not, like, how the law works. And later arguments, later to the Supreme Court, like, unions have tried to use this same sort of reasoning, etc. The Supreme Court hasn't upheld that reasoning ever since. It's like a one-time thing that the Supreme Court used this very radical reasoning. But the radical implications of the reasoning are just that the economy is itself a political instrument. The entire economy is organized politically all the way down, right? Like, the reason why any particular contract, any particular trade is enforced is because of the government. The reason why you can't go into Walmart and steal the candy bar or whatever thing you want to buy, that is because of the state, is because the state has agreed to enforce any particular contract which fits particular instances. And so the left has always argued that the purpose or the role of the economy is entirely political, right? That the economy is itself a political instrument and that it is set up politically. Liberals, on the other hand, have maintained that public-private distinction, that the purpose of government, the purpose of politics, is just to manage the negative externalities of the market, and therefore politicians, their role, their duty, the thing that politicians do, is just to sit over the market as managers. Not too long ago, actually, I saw a perfect example of this. I believe he was a member of Congress, not a senator, but he was arguing basically that Congress needed a raise, that, you know, we should raise up the pay like a couple thousand dollars. And his reasoning, the argument that he used was, look, you know, we're being paid only like 170 whatever thousand dollars, but we are literally the board of directors of the largest economy in the entire world. But, you know, and that just is like a typical sort of example of neoliberal reasoning, which is that, oh, well, we're sitting over this economy, we're managing this economy. But the idea that that's the role of politicians is in question, at least among leftists. Leftists disagree and think that actually, no, state enforcement is deeply involved in all market activity, which, by the way, explains why, you know, when you go to the radical left, you find anarchism, right? Like, a lot of people get surprised by that and think that anarchists are always on the right. You know, you think of like anarcho-capitalists, but actually historically anarchists have always been on the left, and they've always been, you know, radical leftist, basically socialist, right? But when you understand that reasoning, when you understand that leftism is the rejection of that public-private distinction, you can make sense of that sort of weird ideological twist, right? That's why, you know, sort of political debate as it currently exists is so narrow and so many people complain about it, because it seems like the only political debate which we can have is what extent the government should manage the negative externalities of the market, as if the economy was entirely natural, right? Like, you go to economics textbooks and how do they start? They start out with some thought experiment about how markets existed in nature, and that specifically, by the way, there's a great, you know, sleight of hand where market is completely then inflated with capitalist formulations of the market. So it's kind of interesting there. But anyway, I don't want to go too far on a tangent, because I want to bring it back to Joe Biden. What does this all have to do with Joe Biden? Joe Biden doesn't present any kind of policy substance for a reason, because as a liberal, his, you know, deeply held neoliberal beliefs is just that, well, look, we're just trying to manage this thing. We're trying to manage the crisis. We're trying to manage the economy. Whereas leftists like Bernie Sanders, leftists like me, are more interested in trying to restructure the economy and say that in principle, some things in the economy are wrong. Not just I'm trying to manage the bad things which come from the market, as if the market was, you know, natural like a volcano or something. No, the economy is entirely set up by human instruments. And so how everything that happens, the fact that there's 500,000 people sleeping out on the streets, is a political decision, right? Bernie Sanders trying to connect money and politics to the way in which, you know, economic sort of systems result, was trying to make that point. He was trying to connect the fact that that political decisions made it possible for 500,000 people to sleep out on the streets. That's why people like Pete Buttigieg, people like Joe Biden were generally confused. And honestly, they would act offended when you would accuse them of being corrupt, when you would accuse them and say, well, hold on, why are you taking all this money? Because in their minds, they're just trying to manage the economy. So if they take money from actors inside the economy, they're just receiving information about how the economy should run. So the point I'm really trying to make here is this. It's not that Joe Biden intrinsically or necessarily lacks policy substance or is intrinsically and necessarily cringeworthy. It's that in the context of a pandemic, Joe Biden does lack policy substance. In the context of a world in which it is not sufficient to merely manage the negative externalities of the market, Joe Biden lacks policy substance. But Bernie Sanders's approach of actually attempting to restructure the economy from a political lens, that is something which is valuable in the context of a pandemic. So it's not just the fact that Bernie Sanders' policy for policy is better. It's not just the fact that in the middle of a pandemic, it's becoming clear that Medicare for all is the right answer. It's also the case that Bernie Sanders' entire approach to politics makes much more sense in the context of a pandemic, because in the context of a pandemic, we are looking at a crisis, and politics as usual, politics as normal, where politics is just the management of an economy, is not sufficient. And so I really feel like this pandemic has vindicated Bernie Sanders in so many different ways. Again, not just policy for policy, but in his very style and in his very substance. And that's the point I'm trying to make here. It's that the public and private distinction isn't sufficient for times of crisis, isn't sufficient for, in my opinion, even sort of regular times, because regular times are completely awash in racism, in sexism, in transphobia, in homophobia, and on and on and on, right? Because regular times don't really exist. Regular times only exist for certain and small minorities of privileged individuals. That is who regular politics exists for. So that's just my opinion, just sort of some of the thoughts that I have when I watch this cringy video, and I'm trying to explain who in the world thought that this was a good idea. They're just sort of my thoughts, and I'm like, yeah, okay, this is a disaster. So anyway, but you can let me know what you think about it down in the comment section. But if you like this video, I'd really appreciate it if you hit the like button and consider subscribing. Thanks.